who the good guy or bad guy is like I do. You may just want it to end. You may be in denial that it's even a movie. You may be in denial that it's even going on. Maybe you're like, there's nothing going on. What's going on? What's the big deal? Each one of us is dealing with this PTSD in a unique way. And the beauty of it is we get to see our load. We get to see how much we can take. We get to see our unique idiosyncrasies, right? Some of us are suckers for punishment. Every day we put on Trump. Every day we want to watch the data, right? We're suckers. We're like, no, this is my way of being in control. I need to know minute by minute how many deaths, how many hospitalizations. I need to see the curve, right? So some people become obsessive like that. Some people denial. Some people just want to know the end. Some people, you know, so everybody has their own unique bent on the PTSD. So what I'm asking you to do is find out, go inside and become aware of your unique. How are you dealing with this PTSD? How are you handling it, right? Are you handling it by fear mongering? Are you handling it by denial? Are you handling it by action? What are you doing to manage your PTSD? And this is the way to manage it well, by becoming aware of it, by naming it, by claiming it, by seeing it in the mirror, not pretending, oh, I don't have PTSD. If you don't have PTSD in some way, you're in denial. This is some big shit going on, okay? This is big. This is huge. And it's okay to have big feelings. It's okay to say, you know what? Time out. I can't handle this right now. I need to go rest. I need to go on a walk. I need to eat. I need help. So in all my groups, practically, I have created support groups for people to get help. This is a time we need help. If you think you can do this alone, you're mistaken, right? That's why I'm here every day in whatever way I can offer help, because I know people are floundering. I know this is a lot for the psyche to handle. So if your psyche is having a hard time, understand it's because we're in PTSD. And depending on your load, you're cracking or bending or wilting more than someone else. It's okay. Don't feel bad. Don't feel ashamed. It's okay to lose your shit. It's okay to do it in a healthy way, yes? But the most important thing is to name it, claim it, declare it, and then be vulnerable and ask for help. Be vulnerable. You need help, you need help. Right? So in my other group, I'm going to give you the website right now, the link right now. You can join this group. I teach meditation there every day. If you're in that group, you can put hashtag help and one of my coaches from my coaching institute will coach you for 30 minutes for free. Okay? If we can. For the first 30 minutes for free, not forever. So the website link is facebook.com/groups/getsuperpowered. Get superpowered, right? The group was created to help people transform their anxiety. So if you join this group, you don't have to buy the book, but you will get help. My point is that we need to recognize that this is a time for coming together. This is a time for extending. This is a time for reaching out to ourselves and to others. This is not a joke. This is serious. We are terrified. We're all activating our inner children. Okay, our inner little children who want parents who know what the F they are doing to show up. But there are no parents showing up. No one is showing up. We're like, where? Right, thank goodness for a Como, for example, because at least he looks all like a parent and he shows up. So we're all activated and magnetized to Como. If people are out of New York, it's the New York governor. So people in America are like holding on to him. Why? Because we need parents at this time to step up. So our inner children looking for direction, looking for help are being activated. This is normal. This is natural. This is okay. But while we are seeing our inner children, let's call it. Don't think it's you. It's your inner child that is wounded, has been wounded, that is now coming up. Your inner child is scared. Your inner child wants to know what will tomorrow bring. Your inner child wants to know if you will have money to put food on the table. It's okay for your inner child to have those fears. Those are the fears of your inner child. But now we have to activate the adult in us. So the adult could say, hey, we need help. Let me reach out to someone and ask for help for money, ask for help for emotional support. Let me get help through a wisdom course, through a teacher. I need help. Or the adult self could say to the inner child, I got you. We're okay, right? But you have to activate a dialogue between yourself and your fearful PTSD inner child. So why am I doing this talk is to make you aware that maybe you've been having these feelings. Maybe you've been acting out and not realizing what's wrong with you. And now I want to make you realize what's right with you. You are right to be traumatized. You are right to have big feelings. You're right to be afraid. 75% of you is terrified. I am too. It's not a joke. When will this end? Will it ever end? How is it going to end? We know nothing. The uncertainty of tomorrow is terrifying us because we never learned at a young age to live in the present moment. So, all in all, the ultimate teaching right now is we have wounded inner children that get activated through PTSD of any sort. It could be, you know, you feel betrayed by a partner, you feel rejected by a partner. What happens is our old PTSD wounds, our old load gets activated, and then we panic. We panic. We have anxiety. That anxiety has different disguises. Your children have anxiety with different disguises. Tantruming, door slamming, laziness, procrastination, listlessness, helplessness, anger, rage, substance abuse, right? These are the faces of anxiety. We think they are bad behavior. They're not bad behavior. No one wants to behave badly. All of us have a face of anxiety. The anxiety is disguising itself through a reaction. And unless we see that in our own lives, we won't be able to heal the inner child, the anxiety of the inner child. We will keep reacting and then causing spirals of reaction from others. So who is going to break the cycle? Only we can. How? By going within, asking, am I anxious right now? Did I just do a whole yelling match with my teenager or my seven-year-old because I am anxious? Am I eating out of control because I am anxious? Am I watching Netflix over and over and over because I'm anxious? Am I on edge right now and I'm so angry with the government because actually I'm anxious? Right? So when we're anxious, we look for ways to diffuse the anxiety. Part of that is blaming people, right? We're really good at blaming people. And how lucky we are that our government and our parents give us a lot to blame, right? And our children, they're monsters. The government is a monster. Our parents are unconscious. The spouse is lazy and uncooperative. Everyone is a problem. So lucky we are. So we can blame, right? Blame life. Blame our luck, blame fate, blame our American citizenry, blame the Republicans or the Democrats, blame someone. It's so lovely that we have someone to blame all the time. And it's lovely for a moment. We feel good. We inject ourselves with a medication, a drug. We're like, phew, thank goodness I don't have to look at myself. That's the cause of my problem. Not me, he, she, right? So we blame. Okay. We blame for 1 year, 2 years, 10 years, 20 years, right? I always tell young adults who come to me, okay, I'll let you blame your parents till 25. I'm going to give you 7 more years after 18 because you're not really a grown up till 25, 28. Okay, even till 30, blame your parents. But after that, you gotta take charge. And they're like, really? Really? I'm like, really? Because enough. How much to blame? How much to blame? Right? I always say, our parents have every right to be unconscious. Why shouldn't they be unconscious? We think that because they're chronologically older, they should be spiritually wiser. The two don't go together at all. Or we think, oh, someone from an Ivy League is running our country, you know, is in the government, they should be wise. Wisdom, unfortunately, consciousness, unfortunately, has nothing to do with how good looking you are, how rich you are, how educated you are. Nothing. Nothing, 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 right? Therefore, the most wise people you will meet, some of them will be uneducated, will not be the ones on the pulpit, will be the ones on the street, right? So when we realize that we can't blame anyone, at some point, we have to look inside. Look inside and go, okay, I am living with anxiety. I'm bloody miserable. No one on the outside can help me, right? Everyone's a nincompoop. Maybe I need to look at my own nincompoopness and look at my own attitude toward life. This is the only place where the healing begins. So we look it up, then we go inside, then we look at the chains we have created between our own anxiety and reaction. Anxiety, reaction, anxiety, reaction. And we stop it. How do we stop it? By entering the present moment. Right now, you don't have to go clean up your whole load, all the crap that you've created in your life. Can't clean all that up. Past is the past, right? Too bad. That time you got angry, that time you got drunk, that time you ate too much. Now that's in the past. It's not here. That's not how we begin cleaning up the load. We begin cleaning up the load in the present. We enter now. This moment is a whole new moment. And we say, okay, how am I feeling now? Now. Now. And we begin to unclasp anxiety and reaction now. We effed up yesterday. We effed up 10 minutes ago. It's okay. Now. Because that's gone. Even what I just said 5 minutes ago doesn't matter. We're now. In the now. In the now. And how do we do it? By tuning in. The only way I know is meditation. So that's why I teach meditation on that other group for free. Facebook.com/groups/get-superpowered/. Somebody will post the link. I teach meditation every day around 1 or 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Come and join me. Learn how to meditate, because that's the only way you will learn how to live in the present moment. So when we go inside, we check, am I feeling anxious? Okay, now I need to become conscious. When I become conscious, I can begin to manage this anxiety. How do I manage this anxiety? By leaning into it, writing, speaking, talking, connecting to the anxiety. Anxiety is nothing to be afraid of. It's just a wave that right now is constantly waving, okay? It's constantly cresting and troughing. It's okay. Getting in touch with it makes us realize it's always here. I can watch it. I don't have to go under it. I can just see, I'm anxious. If you keep in touch with it through a non-judgmental observance, it doesn't eat you up. And you don't go out there and react. You name it, to claim it, to watch it, to heal it. This is the thing. There's nothing to do with it. Just name it, you claim it, you watch it, you let it be. In the driver's seat. You know, you can't get rid of anxiety. You can't get rid of fear. It's just where you put it in the car. Is it in the driver's seat? Is it right next to you in the passenger seat and squishing you? Is it sitting on your head, right? Or is it in the back seat? And then how big is your car, right? Which means how much space do you have in your being? How much inner space that it's, is it in the back seat right here holding your neck? Or is it way back in a big bus you have? The internal space is so big that anxiety is there, but it's in the back. It's a mistake to think you will be without anxiety in life. This life is PTSD every moment, okay? Every moment. People are constantly going to make you feel at edge, on edge. Life is constantly unpredictable. So don't think it's not to have fear. Don't think the goal is not to have anxiety. The goal is to know where to place it in your life. How much space between you and the anxiety? And then go, hi, anxiety. Oh, there you are again. Oh, and in these times, it's a constant bedfellow. It's in bed with you. It's on the plate with you. It's in the drink with you. And it's okay. Of course. How can it not be? Right? Leaning into it and welcoming it and go, I see you, but I'm not scared of you. Because there is a part of me that is beyond you. There is a part of me that is above you. There is a part of me that trusts and surrenders that I am part of this energetic cosmos and I will never be one wave of the anxiety. I'm just too big. I'm the ocean itself, not the wave of anxiety. I'm the ocean itself. So that awareness comes from constant wisdom, cultivation, and meditation, that we are the ocean, not the waves, yes? We are the sky, not the clouds. So the feelings are the clouds, are the waves. They come and they go, they come and they go. But I am something beyond, I'm something eternal, I'm something limitless and constant. Getting in touch with that, only through meditation, you can learn with me, is the only way to observe. So recognizing that most of our experience in life is subjective. It's coming from within, depending on our anxiety load, depending on our unique circumstances, our emotional baggage, our emotional inheritance and legacy. Your anxiety can never look like mine, so don't expect it to. If you're at home and your kid is freaking out, so just because it's your kid doesn't mean it has to freak out your way. It's freaking out its way. Just because your partner was betrothed to you in a legal document called marriage doesn't mean they owe you any health. It doesn't mean they owe you their coping. They're coping in their way. At this time and all points of crisis, you will uncover your inner child. You will see, oh, my inner child is really, really small, emotionally small. I'm terrified right now. It's okay. Beautiful opportunity to go in and heal that inner child. How do you heal it? You have to learn how to heal it. You have to take courses, wisdom courses, self-development courses. Come meditate with me for free. And that's how you learn to grow your inner child up. But what we're all experiencing is a pandemonium of inner children really, really terrified, waiting for their parents. But the parents aren't going to come. It has to come from within you. You are asked to activate the parent. And if you can activate the parent in this time of uncertainty, then you're going to be able to activate the parent in all times of uncertainty. Times are always uncertain. These for sure are some real weird uncertain times. I'll give you that. But it's okay. It's just a reflection of uncertainty. This uncertainty or that uncertainty. This death or that death. We're all going to die somehow. I'm not making less of it. I'm just saying it's always a part of our lives. So we're experiencing a concentrated, big, shocking trauma right now, together. The beauty is we're doing it together, but it will hit us subjectively. And it's an opportunity to ask ourselves, how am I dealing with this trauma? Because how I'm dealing with this trauma is how I deal with all traumas. Do I rise up? Do I activate altruism? Do I activate action and service? Or am I getting completely bowled over? And depending on our healing, our PTSD load, we will act accordingly. It's okay to not act accordingly. It's okay to not be rising up. Understand that you're not rising up, not because something is wrong with you. It's because your PTSD load is too much. So it's an opportunity now to lighten that PTSD load. How? In the now. Changing now. Changing your relationship with anxiety in the now. How do you do it? You have to learn how to do it. How? Take a course. Follow a teacher. Learn a new skill. But this is what's happening to you, yes? If you're feeling big feelings, which you are, 100%, all of us are, this is the story behind it. So now at least you can name it, to claim it, to watch it, to heal it. So I'm going to read to you a verse from the Tao Te Ching, which is a beautiful book that may help you in this time of great trauma. So verse 12. Colors blind the eye, sounds deafen the ear, flavors numb the taste, thoughts weaken the mind, desires wither the heart. Colors blind the eye, sounds deafen the ear, flavors numb the taste, thoughts weaken the mind, desires wither the heart. The master, the wise one, observes the world, but trusts the inner vision. He allows things to come and go. His heart is open as the sky. Now, when I talked, I swear I didn't even read the what verse, but it always matches because it always matches. Wisdom is wisdom. So what this says is, don't go with the senses. Don't go with the reaction. Don't go with what you see. Connect to the unseen. He trusts his inner vision, the inner vision of who it is you truly are. Who it is you truly are is not your sound, is not your eyes, is not your taste. It's energy, right? He allows things to come and go. As I said, the waves of the ocean, the clouds in the sky. His heart is as open as the sky, meaning he understands that he is something else. He or she is limitless. We are energy. We are cosmos. We will come and go. Today as you, next day as someone else. The iteration of the form is not who we are. We are disguising ourselves as this, but we are really as vast as the sky and the ocean. So when you have an anxiety, a feeling, a trauma, a moment of inner panic, let it come, let it go. It's not who you truly are. It is just a moment in time. It is just a sign of the time. It is a sign of your wounding, sign of your inner child. It's not all of you. Don't let it take you over. Learn how to go within, to claim it, to see it, to heal it. Come and meditate with me. facebook.com/groups/getsuperpowered/. I'm going to meditate there in around 30 minutes. I hope I see you there. Bye, guys. Thank you for joining me, Instagram. So if you want to get all the other stories or my viral wisdom courses, come and join me on YouTube or on Facebook. It's all archived there. Thank you so much. I'll see you here tomorrow.